Dr. Lester W. Cory is a Chancellor Professor Emeritus of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth and Director of the UMass Dartmouth Center for Rehabilitation Engineering. He has been engaged in research and teaching at UMass Dartmouth for more than 50 years. He served on the Rhode Island Air National Guard for 36 years, retiring in 1992 with the rank of colonel. He is a licensed airplane pilot. In 1982, he was one of three professors who founded the Share Foundation, a nonprofit organization that engineers high-tech equipment and enables severely disabled, non-speaking people to communicate independently, some for the first time in their lives. In 1985, he was selected to receive President's Volunteer Action Award and was privileged to dine with the President of the United States in the White House. Among many other awards, he has received citations from the governors of Rhode Island and Massachusetts and from the Rhode Island General Assembly. He was the 1995 recipient of the National Jefferson Award for Outstanding Public Service. Please welcome Dr. Cory.
Thank you, Barbara. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. I don't know when I've ever seen this many students assembled this early in the morning. It looks like some of you were even awake. That's really great. Well, I want to talk to you this morning about some of the work that we have been doing at UMass Dartmouth for the last, since 1981, you do the math, more than 30 years. 30 years ago, technology was a lot different than it is today, and what I'd like to talk to you about is some of the technology of yesterday, some of the technology of today, and maybe we can speculate just a little bit about some of the technology of tomorrow. You folks are living in a marvelous era, a marvelous time. I envy the things that you will see that I will never see. And I'm thrilled at the things that I have seen over the last many years. I look back at my father's era. He was born before the Wright brothers flew their first airplane. And today I can fly airplanes across the sky and not worry about them falling out of the sky. I was born before color TV and before microwave ovens, and you look at things like that and you say, they just come so fast into society. And the thing, of course, which everyone has in their pocket today is a cell phone, a smartphone, some kind of phone. It's amazing when you start to think about how many pieces of technology there are in this room just as a consequence of your being here and bringing your pockets and your handbags. I'd like to talk first about how the work began. In 1981, I met a young lady. A lot of stories begin that way. And this young lady had a very profound influence on my life, and though I didn't marry her, and though she's not my daughter, she was a woman of 24 years of age who was diagnosed with cerebral palsy. And as a consequence of her cerebral palsy, she was not able to walk, she couldn't use her hands, she couldn't speak. Now think about that. If you can't use your hands, that means you can't write, you can't gesture, and if you can't speak, that means literally you cannot communicate, you cannot express your most basic of wants and needs. Now since that time, I have met literally hundreds of people with similar abilities and similar needs. Linda, when she was very young, was unable to communicate by her parents, putting things in front of her that she could look at, and obviously she could control, therefore, we found, the motion of her eyes. And the motion of her eyes became the key to her ability to communicate. Initially, she looked at things. Her father was a real handy man with a jackknife, and he whittled little icons of things that come on the corner and the cousins and the TV set in the kitchen and so forth. And she could initiate communication by looking at one of these little icons. But how much can you say by looking at a little whittled piece of wood that's sitting on a coffee table? Eventually, at a fairly young age, her mother miraculously taught her to read, taught her to spell. Now, she could express herself through spelling. but she couldn't really control the motion of her hand, so no matter how big the letters were that they laid out for her to point to, it was still very difficult and very time-consuming. When she was 5 years old, her parents took her to the local school system and said, here's our daughter, take her to school. And the school system said, no, we're not going to do that. Well, bear in mind, this was quite a number of years ago. Things would be a little different today. I'm not sure the result would be a lot different, but things would be different. They would not be able to say, no, we're not taking your daughter into the school system. She can't speak, she can't write, she can't hold a pencil, she can't toy with herself. No. Bring her back when she can communicate. Well, a number of years later, an engineer down at Raytheon built a system to enable Linda to communicate. What he did was to take a World War II surplus teletype machine and modify it by adding four big switches. These were colored switches the size of saucers. And they were red, yellow, blue, and green. And if she hit those four switches in the proper order, red, red, green, blue, I typed an A. Red, red, green, green, that was a B. And her communication now was such that she could spell things at the rate of, well, maybe one or two letters of the alphabet per minute. Rather slow indeed. In the meantime, her father had invented something out of this piece of plexiglass. It was a means whereby Linda could express her basic wants and needs by simply moving her eyes. How can you spell things by moving your eyes? Well, I'll bet this lady here would like to show us. Come on. Although this is probably the most low-tech piece of equipment that you can possibly imagine, this is an extremely useful device, and I'd like you to know about it, know that it exists, and know how to use it. And it works something like this. You get to hold it, too. Now, we'll imagine that I can't communicate with you any other way than through my eyes. And here's the deal. Right now, am I looking you in the eye?
No.
Am I looking in the eye now?
No.
How about now?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, if someone is looking you in the eye, you can almost feel it. Now, here's the deal. I'm going to look you in the eye through the eye board.
Okay?
Now, I'm looking at the letter N. What I want you to do is to move the board left, right, up, down, however you have to do it, so that I'm looking you in the eye through the letter N. Got the picture? Okay, good. I'm now looking at the letter T, so I want you to move the board until our eye gaze is aligned through the letter T, and you have it. Good. Okay, now, are you married? I didn't think so. Okay. I'm going to spell you the name of my handsome young grandson. Okay. Rules will be like this. I'm going to look at the first letter. You align our eye gaze, and when you have it, you speak the letter. Now, if you're wrong, you won't be. If you're wrong, I will keep staring in the same place. Now, if, for example, you were to say this letter, we can't be off by more than one. So, if I keep staring in the same place, just make a slight adjustment and try another letter. If you're correct, I'll move to the next letter, and you speak that. And when we're all done, I'll look over the top of the board and you speak his name.
Okay.
Ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here we go.
N. I. K. E. Mike.
Thank you. I can't tell you how many times I have walked into a facility where there is a non-communicating person and seen staff members try to play 20 questions with people, frequently most unsuccessfully. This little device, of which I have given away more than 700, is a simple piece of technology that will enable a person who has the ability to spell, the ability to see, and the desire and the intelligence to communicate, to express their basic wants and needs. And if you ever find yourself in a situation where you need one of these, then you get in touch with me and I will make certain that you have as many of these as you need. Are there other ways that you could communicate with someone without even this much technology? You notice this thing requires no batteries and it's easy to store, easy to see, easy to use. There are lots of other schemes that you could use, and you could invent some. For example, I once went into a facility in which I painfully heard a woman working with a young person who had Guillain-Barré, or Guillain-Barré. He was unable to speak. And she said to him, "It's clear that you want to tell me something. And I see that you can blink your eyes. So I'll go through the alphabet, and when I speak the letter, if it's the right letter, you blink once. And if it's not the right letter, you blink twice. Does it begin with A? Does it begin with B?" In 5 minutes, he had spelled out M, Y, L, E, G, S, H. And she said, "There's no word M, Y, L, E, G, S, H. And at that point, when I almost hit the ceiling, I said, "He's trying to tell you that his legs hurt. In the meantime, let's try a different scheme. There's no reason to blink once for yes and twice for no. We can just blink once for yes, and if there's no response, that means no. You try blinking your eyes once for yes and twice for no throughout the alphabet and see how tiring that becomes. Does it begin with A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M? Blink once, there's the M. We go from there. Even easier, after a little bit of practice, is it in the first half of the alphabet? Is it in the second half of the alphabet? Blink once for yes, and don't blink if the answer is no. And now you can break the alphabet down into smaller pieces. You can take a board like this, just write out the alphabet in different rows, and point to a row. The letter that you want. Is it in the first row? Is it in the second row? Is it in the third row? And so on. So if you are ever in a situation in which you need to enable a person to express to you their basic wants and needs, consider something like this, which you can make. Consider any scheme that you could come up with to enable a person to tell you what it is they need, or who they are, or where they're going, or whatever else may be appropriate. In the case of our first person that I dealt with, I can tell you that when I first met with her, I was extremely uncomfortable. I'm an engineer. I don't know anything about people. I don't know anything about cerebral palsy. I don't know if it's contagious. And here I was sitting in the kitchen, and here is her mother moving this board back and forth and saying, "Don't talk to my mother, talk to me." But it was her mother who was talking, not her. And she was just sitting there making sounds that didn't make any sense to me. And I can tell you, I was extremely uncomfortable. I didn't want to be there. And this board looked to me like a Ouija board. And then the most terrible thing happened. Her mother handed me the board and said, "Here, you communicate directly with her." And what ran through my mind is, this is just a cruel hoax. Am I supposed to pretend that something is happening here? But her eyes focused on the letter A, and I said, "A, just as you did." What's your name?
Aaron.
Just as Aaron did. And then it was A, S, K. She looked under the board. That says that's the end of the word. M, E, under the board. A-N-Y-T-H-I-N-G. Ask me anything. Good God, there's somebody there. This is real. And so I asked her a very profound thing. I said, "What are your goals in life?" And I immediately said to myself, "You fool. Why did you ask such a ridiculous question? This woman doesn't have any goals." And she spelled out, "Earn a high school diploma." I said, "You want a high school diploma? Why?" she had been finally to a school. Because of that machine that that engineer built, her family went back to the school system and said, you said bring my daughter back and she can communicate, here's the machine. And they said, tell you what we'll do. We'll pay her tuition to a special needs school, translate that to school for the mentally retarded. It's only 30 miles away, we don't have a bus, and you'll have to carry her there, but we'll pay her tuition. She went there for 7 years, from age 14 to age 21, and at age 21, her family was told, well, she's educated, that's it, it's over. She had probably the equivalent of a fourth grade education. She wanted a high school diploma. And I said, why? And she said, so I can get a job. I said, you want a job? What in the world do you want to do? And her answer is why I am standing here before you today. She said, I want to do something to help people less fortunate than myself. Oh, that is heavy. That's heavy. I left there that night promising that I could do something for her. This is 1981 now. IBM has not put out its first computer yet. Al Gore has not yet invented the internet. There's a lot of things that haven't happened in 1981, and I sat in front of my TRS-80 Model 1 mini computer with 48K of RAM and two floppy disk drives. I didn't say 48K, I said 48K. And throughout that night, because I was up all night working on that system, I finally came to the conclusion that I knew what it was that Linda could use. I built her with a colleague at the university, Professor Phil Weil, built her a single switch communication device. Now, I want to show you about single switch devices because we use a lot of them. Imagine that your computer, instead of having a keyboard and a mouse, had one single switch. Well, let's make the imagining a little easier. It has the space bar. That's the only thing that functions, just the space bar. Now, if you had a computer and the only thing that you had to control it was just the space bar, how in the world would you be able to write things? Could you? The answer is yes. Now, Lisa is hopefully going to show us how we do this. I hope. Lisa's not going to show us anything unless we can get this computer running. Okay, here is my space bar, my single switch. With a single switch system, it's not what you do, it's when you do it. So you can see that what we have arranged here are the letters of the alphabet. We worked with Linda, by the way, in building this system. It took us 3 months to put together a system very similar to what you see here. And we kept talking to Linda about it. Do you want this? Do you want this? Would this be something that you would want to have and so forth? And what we originally intended to do was to simply to enable her to spell words. If you want the letter A, for example, all you need to do is to press the switch when the spot is over the column containing the letter A. And then the spot, instead of moving horizontally, will move vertically. And you can select the letter A by closing the switch a second time. We spent a lot of time trying to figure out what it was that Linda could do. And eventually, we decided that the thing she could do best was to control the motion of her head. So on her wheelchair, we put a micro switch behind her head. So her single switch was activated by her moving her head. Since then, we have put switches in so many places. We have switches in places that I didn't even know people had places. And I'm going to pan some of those switches around in a moment. But let's see how this works. Initially, what we were going to do was to just let her spell words. But then we said, maybe we can let her select words. So right now, if I select the letter A, I don't get the letter A. What I get is words beginning with A. So let's just close the switch when the spot is over the second column. And we'll say, yep, we're going down the column. And I hit the switch a second time when letter A was selected, or letter A was illuminated, and now I have words beginning with the letter A. So if I want the word adventure, for example, I can select that column, that entry, and there at the bottom of the screen is adventure. And of course, every woman likes to go shopping, so we had let's go shopping, but that's one of the many phrases. So I'm going to select phrases out of the fourth column. When phrases is illuminated right now, I will select it, and we now have phrases from which we can select. And Linda has the ability to change the word list and change the sentence list and change the phrases. So if she wanted to say, for example, I will show you how I use my computer, I select the first column and the third entry.
I will show you how I use my computer.
Now, when we began construction of this system, there was not a speech synthesizer in this entire universe that you could afford. Today, speech synthesizers are everywhere. A talking computer is, it's just such low tech as far as any of you are concerned. It must have always existed. Well, I can tell you in 1981, it did not exist. And I was doing some research for the U.S. Navy in speech recognition. I was trying to build a computer system that you control by talking to it. Again, to you folks today, that's not technology, that's just something that happens. But in 1981, it didn't happen. It just didn't exist. And several of us working down in Newport, Rhode Island, built one of the world's first computer systems that you control by talking to it. It cost about $250,000 to build that first system, but it would recognize 20 different words. That was pretty good. We built a second one a couple of months later. Cost about $70,000, and it did 120 words. And about 2 months after that, we built another one. It cost about $17,000 or $18,000, and that one would do almost 1,000 words. We made the headlines. It was, wow, you can control a computer by talking to it. The director of the center came down to see me and says, Dr. Cory, I just have one real fundamental question for you. I said, yes, sir, what's that? Why didn't you build a $17,000 one first? You cost us a lot of money back here. I said, well, unfortunately, research doesn't always work that way. I was sitting in my office down there one day when in comes a phone call. And the phone call is from a company called the Young Spring and Wire Company. And they say, are you the person who is working on speech synthesis? And I says, no, I'm working on speech recognition. Oh, we were told that you were working on speech synthesis. That's producing speech with a computer. No. So, well, we have a new product. I said, really, what's that? It enables a personal computer to produce speech. We thought the Navy might be interested. Now, I had already started work on this system for Linda, and I said, oh yes, the Navy's very interested. And the bottom line is, we wound up with speech synthesizer serial number 2, which wound up in Linda's hands. Absolutely a fluke, a coincidence. No reason why that phone call should have been misdirected to me, but it was. No reason why this company should have come up with this product right then, but they did. No reason why we should have gotten serial number 2, because we were told there was no way we were going to get that synthesizer, but we did. And Linda received it. Coincidence. I can tell you that throughout the last 30 years, I can give you 24 more examples, even more exotic, of coincidence that has influenced our work. I can't tell you how often I get a phone call of someone who has this exotic thing or this exotic need. And you say, this is of no interest, there's nothing I can do with this information. And then a day or a week or a month later, something happens, you say, ooh, boy, am I glad I wrote down that phone call. And you put things together. I'll digress just for a second. I was sitting in the lab one day in 1985, working on a particularly perplexing problem. Didn't really want to be bothered with anyone. I probably even had missed a class that day, and it was, for me, that was very rare. The telephone rings, and I pick it up, and the person at the other end says, "This is the White House calling, and the president would like to invite you to come to lunch." I said, "Who is this?" And the person identified herself and said, "Look, I don't have time. What are you selling?" "Not selling anything." "President of the United States?" I said, "Look, don't give me that. Who are you? What do you want?" She said, "Well, just take down my number and call me back." So I jotted down the number and went about my work. A little while later, in comes one of my colleagues. He says, "What's this phone number?" I said, "I don't know. Some woman says the President of the United States wants us to come to lunch." He says, "That area goes Washington, D.C., you know." I said, "No, it's not." He said, "Yeah, it is." I said, "You ain't on this?" Bottom line is, my wife and I were fortunate to have lunch with the President of the United States, who talked to us about the work that we had done. At that time, we had worked with about 300 different individuals. After we built that first system for Linda, which you're seeing a model up here, we got a lot of publicity. I almost wish we hadn't, but we did. And as a consequence of that publicity, people with needs for devices to enable them to communicate called us and asked if we could help. The first reaction was, "We've already built this. It's not a problem. We'll just build another one." But the second person couldn't read. "Oh, that kind of changes the problem, doesn't it? Can't we teach this person to read?" "Well, not in any short period of time." So we wound up building a second system. That system employed nothing but pictures. And I'll show you a picture system in a moment. Third person was a person who was blind. He was a typist, but he says, "Sometimes my fingers get slipped by a row and I type gibberish. Sure would be nice if when I type something, it would speak what I had typed." So we built him a system that spoke what he typed. The next person came along was a person who could speak just fine, but couldn't do anything from the neck down because of a spinal cord injury. And I got to thinking, that person could control that computer that we built for the Navy by talking to it. Very expensive, but yeah, we could do that. Over the years, we have now worked with more than 3,600 different individuals, and they reside in 38 different states and 7 countries. Not every system is unique, but people's abilities are unique. And what we have found over the years is that in order to work effectively with a person, we need the answers to 2 fundamental questions. First question is, what are this person's abilities? Because the abilities determine the inputs to the system. If a person's highest functioning ability is to raise their eyebrows, kind of needs to be an eyebrow switch in the system. And I promise you I would show you some things, so why don't I show you some things, like an eyebrow switch, for example. Now, this is an eyebrow switch from 25 years ago. It mounts on this Velcro strap, and in front of it there's this little wheel. The wheel sits on one's forehead, and by raising and lowering one's eyebrows, you can control the switch. So a person could control, we can hand these around, a person could control the use of a computer system by simply raising and lowering their eyebrows. So in dealing with a person, first question is, what are the abilities? What does this person bring to bear on the problem? Because the abilities determine the inputs. Second question is, what are the needs? What are we trying to accomplish? What does this person need to be able to do? Does this person live independently and need to be able to call 911? Well, better be a phone dialer in the system, or something like it. the needs determine the outputs. I mentioned to you a moment ago that we had worked with about 3,600 different individuals. Excuse me. We have built somewhere between 12 and 15,000 different systems. That's a lot of systems. Why for only 3,600 people, 3,400 people, why would you have to build 12 to 15,000 systems? And the answer is three things change. The abilities change. The person with Lou Gehrig's disease has declining abilities, and we've worked with more than 350 people with Lou Gehrig's disease. And it's a universally fatal neuromuscular affliction that deprives a person of effectively every ability in life except the ability to think clearly. A person in that who has Lou Gehrig's disease is frequently using a respirator, unable to speak, unable to do much from the neck down, but typically able to control the motion of their eyes, able to think. Abilities change. Needs change. Linda didn't need to be able to send email. There wasn't any email. Today there is. She needs to be able to handle email. She didn't need to surf the internet. There wasn't any internet. So people's needs change. And as a person's physical ability changes, they may have a need to do things through technology that formerly they did using some physical ability. And the third thing that changes is technology. Linda's Radio Shack TRS-80 Model 3 was a wonderful machine. It only cost $3,000 in those days. But today, the technology would be laughable. We do a lot of things today with single-switch devices. And we modify a lot of things to make them useful for people. And I'm looking for some toys here. Here's a device that I picked up this morning. I usually sit this on the couch next to where I am because I'm too lazy to get up and do things. And it enables me to turn things on and off. The radio reception is terrible here, but we're using here a technology called X10, and I'd like to spend just a couple of minutes talking about X10 technology. Now, whereas I control this with my hand, X10 can be integrated into a computer program like Linda's. So Linda can control things with her head. And the question is, what kinds of things can she control? Well, if you look in the X10 catalog, and I don't see anybody taking notes, but that's okay, X10 is a wonderful technology. How many of you have any X10 or X10 experience? I'm really surprised. Okay. First, this little gadget here cost me $6. And the module that plugs in the wall over there cost me $9. So for $9 for a few dollars, I can turn things on and off. Like what kinds of things? First, I would like to restate something that I saw here on this campus. It was a banner. And I took that banner home. And it's been sitting in my office ever since. And it says, I can't believe I forgot exactly what it says. Hate when that happens. For you and me, technology makes things better. For people with disabilities, technology makes things possible. Linda cannot get up and turn her radio on and off. But through X10, she can. X10 devices would enable you to control your ceiling fan. It would enable you to adjust your thermostat. It would enable you to motor drive your drapes to open and close them. If you stop believing me, just let me know. X10 technology would enable you to lock and unlock your door. X10 technology will enable you to feed the goldfish. You okay with that? Okay. It's true. Yes, you can buy a goldfish feeder for X10. You can buy an X10 device that will enable you to turn on the TV camera outside your door and display an image of the person who is at your door on your TV set so you can see who it is that's at the door to determine whether or not you want to open the door and let them in. We take devices like these. This is a two-channel version of that system, but here's a four-channel version of it. And we modify them in such a way that instead of pushing a button, that these things scan just as these single switch system that I indicated to you earlier scans. And if you want to turn on device number four, which might be to close the drapes or open the drapes, then you wait until that is illuminated, press the switch, and that enables you to control that device. So a lot of things today are single switch. One thing today that people want to be able to control is a telephone. Now, this is a phone that's a little bit different than the ones that you have probably, because this is a single switch telephone. It's actually a combination of a single switch telephone and a voice control phone. We do a lot today with voice control. This, for example, is a voice control TV remote. We can hand that around as well. You can say such things as power on, power off, channel up, channel down, volume up, volume down, and by means of your voice, you can control what your TV set does. This telephone is a combination of a single switch phone and a voice control phone. If this phone is ringing, all you have to do is say hello, and you just answer the phone. And when you're done with the conversation, you can use your voice, or you can use a single switch to effectively shut the telephone off. If you use your single switch, which can be part of a computer program or can be a standalone device, then these lights scan in sequence, and there are 20 pre-stored telephone numbers, and you can call any of those 20 numbers by simply pressing a switch at the right time. This happens to be a fairly expensive telephone. It's about $400, but despite the fact that it's a $400 telephone, it enables a person who typically cannot control things themselves, perhaps a person who is spinal cord injured, to be able to still have the independence of handling their telephone. One of the things that's nice about the X10 technology is that it is not limited to your own home, and it's not, as you saw, controlled by wires. Well, in a sense, X10 is controlled by wires because it uses the house wiring to carry a signal from one point to the next. But that signal doesn't stop at the edge of your home, which means, and this will be interesting to some of you, if you have an X10 device and your neighbor has an X10 device, that you can not only control your drapes, you can control your neighbor's drapes as well. You can not only turn on your lights, you can turn on your neighbor's lights as well. Now, when you wake up in the middle of the night and something went bump, then X10 typically has one of its choices, all on. So you select all on, and everything that's connected to an X10 module suddenly comes on. So you light up your whole house and turn on your CD player and your radio and your TV and everything else. And if that doesn't scare away the thing that went bump in the night, then you can activate the next feature, which would automatically call 911. The thing that I like most about the X10 is not so much the all on, I never use that. But what I do use at the end of the day is the all off. It says, whatever I turned on somewhere in the house and I haven't gotten around to looking at yet, please turn it off for me. So X10, it's a simple technology, it's easy to use. Sometimes people have an ability, but they're limited to gross hand motion. You and I can use the fine, the small controls on a numeric keypad. But if a person lacks fine dexterity, then this is perhaps an alternative. We use a keyboard called Big Keys. The Big Keys keyboard was built for children. What it says on the front of it is, little fingers need big keys. Well, not only do people with little fingers need big keys, but people with big fingers need big keys if they lack fine motor control. So we hand out keyboards, and the keys are about twice the size of the keys on this to enable people to be able to make more effective use of technology. Now, One of the things that that I have started carrying these days is one of these. This is obviously not for someone who likes fine motor control, and the question is, well, what the heck is that? It's a TV remote control is what it is. And it enables me to turn a TV on, off, channel up, channel down, volume up, volume down. That's generally all I want. My TV remote control has almost got about 50 buttons, and I can never find the button that I want. I know there's a mute button in there somewhere, but the telephone rings and I can't find it. But I can find the mute button on this. But the thing that's more enjoyable about this to me is I can take it into Dunkin' Donuts and change their TV channel or adjust their volume. Well, the sip and dip donut store, I was sitting in my doctor's waiting room the other day and this infomercial was on, and I didn't want to watch that infomercial. There were about maybe not quite as many people as there are in this room, but maybe half as many. And they were kind of saying ho-hum to the infomercial, and I quickly reprogrammed this, which you do with a single button, and changed the channel to something more interesting, and everyone looked around and went, how did that happen? And then I adjusted the volume, and people looked around still more. We take devices like this, modify them for a single switch input, and turn them into scanning devices. So yes, you can control your TV set with something this small using nothing but your voice. Today, the tendency is away from laptop computers towards something smaller. Lisa, can you make me go? Today we are using more and more tablet computers and things for smartphones. There are a lot of apps for tablets for people with disabilities. And we're going to see one, I think, in a moment, maybe not. Yes, no, maybe?
Yeah.
Please look and make it go, we'll see it. I'd like to talk to you about one of my clients. Just one. Well, let's take a look at this. This is designed for a preschool person, probably, and it presumes that a person has dexterity, but if a person did not have dexterity, we can turn this into a scanner. And
to play with a ball. I want to play with blocks.
Can you do a little less? Oh, that's me. Okay, sorry. We don't need to really do any more. Somehow we get back to where we came from. Okay, that's a tap to talk, start, and we can select.
Let's go.
It's a sound on your iPad. Just
here. I want to go to a restaurant. Let's go to the burger place.
Bottom line is there are a lot of apps today that are useful for tablet computers, and these can be either direct select or they can be useful in single switch operating mode. We try very hard to make Linda's computer, her TRS-80 Model 3, portable. Now, the closest we could get to portability was mounting it on its own wheelchair, so that when Linda went out, she went out with two wheelchairs, one she was in and the other one her computer was in. But today, we can easily mount an iPad on her wheelchair so that she can take that technology with her. Today, there are more and more apps available for smartphones. I have a close friend who is blind, and she is able to determine the denomination of money by simply waving that money over her smartphone, and it tells her it's a $1 bill or a $5 bill. She can also color coordinate her outfit in the course of a day by asking the smartphone what color something is that's hanging in her bedroom. And she can decide whether she wants to color coordinate blue with green or maybe not. There are not as many apps for smartphones as there are for tablets, but those things are coming very quickly. I mentioned to you that we built some speech recognition devices some time ago. Lest I leave you with the thought that only simple things like that are available for the tablet, let's look at one that's a little bit more involved. This one is called Verbally, and here you see you have the option of selecting words. You can also use the keyboard to write words. So if you want to say, I want something, then you just select I, And you'll note that in the construction area in the left center of the screen, the word I has just appeared. And I, well, most people, when they say I, what they really mean is I want something, so I want what? I want my, well, what I want is, I want my mommy. It's not there, but I can speak it.
I want my mommy.
And again, for a person who does not have the ability to speak, something like this, a simple application for a tablet, which can be used either in direct select mode or in scanning mode, can enable a person to express their basic wants and needs. No system like this is anything like as fast as things as you and I can use our voices. And the downfall of all of this is that today it's slow. That's technology today. Where are we tomorrow? Well, almost today, you're probably aware of the fact that Google has just put a new product on the market. It's available off the West Coast. Anybody know what it is?
Google Glass.
Google Glass is right. Who said that? You did. Yes, that's exactly right. Google Glass. Google Glass is effectively a video display that sits on an eyeglass frame, and it's transparent, but it enables you to see the equivalent of the output of a monitor screen. And you wear it. It goes with you where you go. Google Glass has been on the market all of a week before a new case, new legal problem arose. It seems a person was driving down the road using Google Glass a little bit over the speed limit, and state trooper pulled this person over and said, "What's that thing you're wearing?" And that thing was Google Glass. So the question arises as to whether that person was illegally using something. It would have been illegal to be texting on the phone. It would have been illegal to do certain other things. And now there's going to be a case in court to determine whether or not it's legal to drive with Google Glass. Google Glass is today. You'll see it in this area probably within the next few months. So if you want to wear your smartphone such that it's always in your field of vision, or if you want to connect your tablet to it through Bluetooth, so whatever's going on your tablet, you can see right in front of you, and you can, by the way, see through it. So you simply change your point of reference as to whether you want to focus on what's immediately in front of you or what's out of the distance. I can see this. I'm an airplane pilot, and I can see this being useful to me entering a traffic pattern. So I have the choices. I can look at the traffic pattern that's sitting down here on my tablet, and I can just change my frame of focus and actually look out the window and see what's out there. What's coming tomorrow, and tomorrow is not going to be that far away, is that it will be not a one-way device, but a two-way device. You're going to not only be able to get information from Google Glass, but you will be able to use your eye to select things that's visible to you on the screen. Today, eye gaze technology is becoming more and more popular. The first eye gaze system that I had experience with was back in 1994, and it was produced by a company called LC Technologies in Fairfax, Virginia. And that system from LC Technologies had a list price of $24,000. For $24,000, you could focus on a screen and spell things by looking at the displayed keyboard on the screen. So if you looked at the letter A, it typed an A. If you looked at a word, it typed the word. If you looked at a function, it activated the function. So if one of your functions was TV on, you could look at TV on and it turned the TV on. Or you could look at answer the phone and it would answer the phone. Or you could look at close the drapes and it would close the drapes. Or you could look at feed the dog and it would feed the dog. That technology is rapidly coming down in price. The second one we bought, we paid $18,000 for. And there was a fellow in my office just a couple of weeks ago who showed me one that he had built with parts that he got from Ocean State Job Lot. I said, how much, how much money do you have invested in this? And he says, well, probably about $25. And for $25, he was controlling his computer by looking at it, and it would do, I would guesstimate, 95% of what today's $10,000 devices would do. That technology is going to be available to you very soon for very little money. And the reason it's going to be available very soon for very little money is because there are two toy makers who are picking up this technology. You're not going to see it this Christmas, but you will next year. And you're going to find toys that you control by looking at them. One of my clients was a gentleman whose name was Brian Dickinson, and I'll use his name because he used ours. He was the editorial journalist for the Providence Journal. And the Providence Journal called and told me that this fellow, told me that their editorial journalist had lost the ability to type. We set him up with a system they controlled by talking to it. This was the early 1990s, and they spent more than $10,000 on that. When he lost the ability to speak, we built him a system that he controlled by moving his thumb. And somewhere in here, there's a thumb switch, but I can't find it, so you don't get it. By the way, here's a smaller writing board for people who don't want to carry a big one, but Aaron and I would have had difficulty using this one. When he couldn't move his thumb, we built a system that he controlled by moving his chin. And when he couldn't move his chin, we modified it to a system that he controlled by raising and lowering his eyebrows. And when he couldn't raise and lower his eyebrows, we built him a system he controlled by blinking his eyes. He could still do that up until the day that he died. But his question to me was always, what next, Les? What he knew that his disease was such that his abilities would be declining. And he always wanted to know, when I can't do this anymore, what will we do next? And the answer that I gave him was, you'll use a system that you control by changing your thought patterns. That is a technology that is here today. I have a system called a mind mouse. It's a commercially available product, and it enables you to do things by changing nothing but, well, your attitude, basically. Works on a sweatband, three electrodes sit on your forehead, and by changing your thought patterns, you can control a computer. That, too, is coming to a toy near you in the near future. The keyboard and mouse that you're familiar with on today's computers is a thing of the past. It's going away. You're going to control your computers to a much greater degree in the very near future by talking to it, by looking at it, and by changing your thought patterns. Now, let me not leave you thinking that the day after tomorrow you're going to put on a helmet and think about a tree that's going to write T-R-E-E. No, that's not going to happen. But today you can control a single switch by changing your thought patterns. We measure the frequency of oscillation of brain waves, very easy to do. You can learn to control the frequency of oscillation of your brain waves without great difficulty, and thereby you can control a single switch device similar to one that Linda has, wherein you can select from things you want to say, things you want to do, things you want to control, people to whom you want to communicate anywhere in the universe, games that you want to play, music that you want to compose, all of which you will be able to do in the very near future by changing your thought patterns. That's tomorrow. You know where we are today. I want to thank you very much for allowing me to be with you today. I've enjoyed it. I hope you picked up a few little tidbits from my being here. Thank you.
We'll turn back to Barbara for a minute.
People,
well,
I just want to thank you so much for coming out. And here's a snow red socks, but it's even better. Your own CPDC shirt.
I don't know if I mentioned, I am a Bridgewater graduate. I have three masters, one of them is from here. I walked on the campus today and recognized absolutely nothing. I have no idea where my classes were, but they were here. But I will treasure this. Thank you, Barbara.